Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Joby Nunez, and on behalf of the Cathcart family, I want to thank you all for coming today to honor a truly special man, a great man, Sam Cathcart. But before we start, I want to remind everybody to please turn your cell phones off until the ceremony is concluded. At this time, I'd like to introduce Lieutenant John Blankenship, U.S. Navy retired, co-founder of the Pierre Clayson's Veterans Foundation of Santa Barbara, Lieutenant John Blankenship.
Thank you, Joe. I want to tell you how proud I am to be here today and what a privilege it is to be able to be part of this ceremony to truly a great individual and a military figure who we honor and will always honor. So now I would like you to stand as we have the presentation of the colors followed by the national anthem. Present the colors. This is Santa Barbara's own Sea Cadets Air Pack Squadron. All right, now we'll have follow through with the rest of the military decor.
represent Harms.
We'll now have the folding of the flag ceremony. You may now be seated. Joe, take it away for the rest of the program.
Thank you very much. It's an honor and a privilege to be here today. I was very fortunate to know Sam Cathcart. I was lucky to have played for him, later got to coach with him, and then even coached against him. I got to coach his son, Scotty Cathcart, back in 1972. That's really when I started to know the Cathcarts. And then later on, I was very fortunate and privileged to coach with Scotty's two older brothers, Sammy Cathcart, when I was working out at Dos Pueblos High School. And then later back in the early 80s, I got to coach with Steve Cathcart along with Lito Garcia. Having been around the Cathcarts for many, many times and many, many hours of fun, they truly treated me special, almost like family. Sam Cathcart made a tremendous impact on my life, but also did for many of you who are here today. And you had the privilege of knowing, had the privilege of knowing him and playing for him. Thank you. Our first speaker will be Colonel Tyson Wilson, U.S. Air Force retired, former commanding officer of the 425th Civil Affairs Unit, and former principal of Carpenter Junior High School, and a very close friend of Coach Cathcart. Tyson?
Thank you very much. I'm sure Sam would like me right off the bat to tell you that I was not the former commander of the 425th Civil Affairs Unit. I was the training officer, and I think that'll get him off my back in a hurry. Sam was a wonderful fellow. Going back to the early 60s, the name Sam Cathcart was a very important name in Santa Barbara in athletics and sports. I read about him a lot, and that's all I ever knew. I didn't even know what he looked like. And then I graduated from UCSB and taken ROTC, which he had also done only a couple of years ahead of me. And when I got out after having taken 4 years of ROTC, I decided to quickly join the Army Reserve here in town. And I did, and there was Sam Cathcart, and I met him for the first time. And we became extremely good friends. We were just always special, and then we got together with our wives, and we became very close with our wives and our children growing up. And we would go to summer camp every summer for 2 weeks, and Sam and I would always sleep together or spend in the bunks right close to each other, and we would always eat our 3 meals a day together, and we would always talk. And you would think that probably we would talk about the military and all of its problems and why things weren't going well and whose fault this was. We never once mentioned that. All we talked about was our families and how much fun they were and what a great time we always had with them. We always were going somewhere and would always share that with each other. Sam and I were just so devoted to our wonderful families that it meant much more to us than anything else. And this continued after we got out of the Army Reserves, our closeness and our phone calls and our sharing. And forever, I will remember. I think one of the most important things we have in life is friendship. I can't think of anything more important than money and family than third place would be friendship. And Sam Cathcart fits under that friendship title and will be there with me for the rest of my life, and I just, God bless you, buddy. You were the greatest guy and best friend I ever had. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker really doesn't need an introduction, but you all know who he is. Mike Moropoulos, the former director of athletics and head coach at Santa Barbara High School, and many would say, during their heyday, when Coach Cathcart and Coach Moropoulos were together, Coach Moropoulos was his right-hand man. Coach Moropoulos?
Thank you. Thank you, Joe. First of all, it was an honor for me to be invited to speak at Sam's special ceremony. We're not here to mourn the loss of Sam Cathcart. That's already been done. We're not here to mourn. I tell you, besides, just part of him's gone. Part of Sam Cathcart is right there on the sideline in Peabody City. And he'll always be there. I brought my clipboard because if you're a coach, you got to have a clipboard. And of course, I want to make sure we understand that he's now with his beloved wife, Susan, and we're here to honor that. You know, I've been around a lot of great athletes in my lifetime. I've been around all pro guys and all Americans and all of that. But I've been lucky enough in my professional life to work with the two best athletes I have ever known, Chuck Sylvester and Sam Cathcart. Incredible athletes. I mean, I've never known a baseball player that they walked with bases loaded. They wouldn't pitch to Chuck. And Sam, the other guy, I've never known anyone who was all conference in three different sports in college. Football, obviously, a track champion, and a boxing champion. I've never known anybody who was in seven halls of fame. I'm not going to take the time to name them all. And I've never been around anyone that's won 143 football games. And most of them were right here. And right now, with that great spirit, I would like to commend those four kids for helping Sam take care of their mom, Susie, and then for them to take care of Sam. Sherry, Steve, Sammy, Scott, I can't believe how they reacted as a family and how they took care of Sam. And of course the extended family too, which are all over the place here, which is great. I'm impressed. And I'm very thankful because of your help to your parents and in their troubled years. And thank you on behalf of all of us here. Thank you for taking care of our coach. I am impressed. This is a tough assignment. I'm not going to talk about names and local schools. I'll leave that up to your imagination. I don't want to say a name. So what about the next guy? I mean, we're talking about 90 years here. This stadium was built in 1925. When you're as old as I am, it seems like everything is 30 years ago, no matter what it is. I asked Scotty a question the other day about this when he worked at the CIF office, and Scotty says, "Coach, that was 20 years ago." Everything is. But it's tough. Who do you leave out when you say a name? Well, how about the next guy? So we don't do that. You ask Sam Cathcart who his best player was. He's going to tell you. He wouldn't even tell his kids. Ask him who the best team was. I'm not going to answer that question. How about the next team? I mean, so it's really tough. To give you some concept of Sam's coaching and military background, let me mention some sideline signals, right? My friend used to say his signals were draw, sweep, power. My signals, I was a little more conservative than that. My signals were 5, 6, 7, 8. Pretty simple. You know what Sam's were? This is Sam. That was the formation. The play was it. I didn't even know what those things were. But the big one, the Army guys here will appreciate that, was attack. That was his philosophy. Attack. And that was his signal for it. Well, that was his signal for everything. Go for it, attack. You know, he had first time I ever saw it, he had a banner over his desk that said, lead, follow, or get the hell out of the way. I mean, that was Sam. And they did. His offense never stopped. I mean, it doesn't matter about the down or distance. He didn't pay attention to that stuff. Just go for it. Get after it. So what if it's fourth down and one or fourth down and 15? Just go for it. Attack. And, of course, that helped us. It helped me with the defense, because on defense we didn't bend and we didn't break. We just attacked. And sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. But that was a philosophy. And you know, Sam won 143 games, and I told you that most of them were right here in Peabody Stadium. But you know what? They were against Long Beach Poly, Loyola, Muir, L.A. Fremont, L.A. Birmingham, who were city champs. You know, Sam says, bring them on. Bring the best on. We'll go for it. Come on. And that part of it is pretty impressive. I asked my friend across town, I said, huh? How is your offense going without your quarterback? Because he was dinged a little bit. He says, offense. He says, who has time for offense? He says, I'm playing Sam Cathcart Friday night. So, I mean, single wing tee, sweep, power, belly, fullback, swerve. I remember one that stands out in my mind is Sam. We were down in the big time, Orange County, playing Anaheim. We had the ball on the 30-yard line. We were behind, third down. Old Sam, he never even thought about that. Sweep left. The next down was fourth down and 15 to go for a touchdown. Sweep right, touchdown, Santa Barbara wins. I mean, he never even gave that a thought. He just said, let's go. What are we talking about? I remember, and a lot of, you know, some of these things I'm mentioning, some of you guys were part of. St. Paul. We're down there, we're losing. The ball's on their 45, fourth down, and their free safety was right in front of our bench, and he was strutting around doing the fancy dance stuff, and he flipped Sam off. That was a mistake. Sam called a play. We called fullback middle. We snapped. Pass, caught, juked the free safety, touchdown, Santa Barbara wins. I mean, that was a wild time with guys all over the sideline. But like I said, he made a mistake. But, you know, no one's perfect, right? Sam had his quirks. He thought his players should say sir and ma'am. And he thought they should respect their parents. And he thought they should go to class and wear clean clothes. And imagine this. He thought they should be on time and ready to practice when they got here. So that was a quirky guy, right? Can you imagine that, expecting kids to play hard? And Tyson was talking about his friendship with Sam. I stood shoulder to shoulder with Sam for, what, I don't know, 20 years or something. I mean shoulder to shoulder every day. And we rode together to every away game in the same seat front right seat. Sam and I sat there together. We never separated. What did we talk about? Football, what we were going to do. We didn't argue. We never had an argument. In fact, that's why I'm here, and I've been here so long, because Sam offered me the opportunity to coach. So why would I ever leave the Santa Barbara Dons? I look around and think, well, you know, this place is offering me jobs. No, I'm sorry. No way, I'm staying here. So I did. And don't ask me about how he won the Silver Star. He never told me. He never talked about it. Even if you asked him, he wouldn't talk about it. But his, you know, his strength and his mind and his physicality are really iconic. He's a special guy. Some history here. Don't ever forget that all this started back in the 1920s. It was started by Clarence Schutte. Probably a lot of you don't know him. We're not going to get into that right now. But just don't ever forget Clarence Schutte is starting this tradition that we're enjoying right now. And then those who maintained that tradition, Lou Chuchibus, was part of it, and of course Sam Cathcart, and then a fat Greek guy got in there, and Coach Lito Garcia. I mean, we believed in it. We were believers, and it worked for us. Our association with Sam, even my family, runs right through. It starts running his spirit through Pasadena, through Long Beach, through the battlefields of Europe, of course, San Francisco with the 49ers, UCSB All-Conference. But you know what? It stops right here. That's after all that stuff with Long Beach and all those, but it stops here. And we've been able to enjoy and appreciate that. And don't forget, while I'm thinking about it, about the administration it takes to be successful. You need good, solid people. We had Maynard Mayles, probably no one remembers him. He was here for 25 years. And then Claude Hardesty and Gene Snyder. And you couldn't ask for more support. And we talk, the military is here, and they're all about leadership, right? Well, Sam, one night, I got to tell you this story. We're going to Hueneme, and we left a little early because we were going to dress down there, put our uniforms on down there in Hueneme. Well, when we got pretty close down there, all of a sudden there was a big traffic jam because there was an accident. We couldn't get through. Sam says, pull over. The driver pulls off to the side. We safely get our kids off the bus, and there was a big housing tract under construction. Sam told our kids, go in there and change your clothes. Those guys were in those old houses with 2x4s and plywood and all that stuff. It was under construction. They changed their clothes, put on their Don's uniforms, came back out on the bus, and we went down there and beat up on Hueneme, and they sang and cheered all the way home. I mean, that didn't bother Sam. He just said, let's go. The other one, of course, I probably shouldn't tell you this one, but I am. We pulled into a school down there in Ventura County, and again, we were going to dress down there. Lock gate. We honked the horn. I said, turn on your flashers. And the kids were yelling out the window. We couldn't get in. There was a chain link gate stopping us. So I went west, Sam Cathcart went east. When Sam came back, he turned into Sergeant Cathcart of the 75th. He said to the driver, drive right through it. The driver put her in low gear, boom, popped that gate open, boy, and were our guys wired up then? After you've been through it, Sam's been through a lot, gate, and that much. And you know, this is true. I don't sound like I'm kind of pushing up on this. It didn't hurt the bus. There wasn't a scratch on that bus. Because I went and looked. It broke a chain. The gate wasn't damaged. We were in. I don't know whatever happened, but Sam just took over. That was Sergeant Cathcart, man. People ask me all the time, every place I go, how's Sam doing? You see Sam? They're worried about Sam. And my answer had to become, hey, look, I don't know where Sam is right now, but I will guarantee you this, wherever he is, he's going 100 miles an hour. And that of course, was Sam. I keep saying that Sam was tough. He's the toughest guy I've ever known. And I keep saying that. But I also want to make sure that people understand, in his way, he always had the welfare of his players at heart. And, of course, with his family, too. He believed. And as his partner, I was right next to him and bought into it. I got to tell you a funny story. Sam wasn't much about trick plays.
Okay, guys, we made it one-on-one. So we really kind of help our center with that thing, and what we call a double team. Two men are going to block that one guy right there if he's a good football player. And usually he's their strongest lineman. He's going to stop line play and things. So the nose guard is going to be a tough guy to block. Okay, this guy is going to try to take a shot. Whatever he can do to get on the tackle, if the tackle is well outside, they might take a shot at him, and just to hold him, to get his, to put his hands down, take him a block low. Now, you can't do that nowadays. Then this guy is going to come around, and as the ball is centered, here's the set, we're going to set this guy up. He's a key right there. What are we going to do with him? As the ball is centered, he takes a step foot, a lead step with his right foot, and he's going to start right at this play. This man is going to start right there one step, so that he has to kind of come in and think he's coming in. This guy is going to try to come in.
He didn't think he wanted to win football games with trick plays. He said, knock them down. Well, he had to go to an Army Reserve meeting, and he couldn't be back in time for our fourth period football class. So he says, Mike, will you take these guys and work on power? Just work on power. That's all. Okay. Yeah, I can do that, Sam. So he wasn't there. We met, and I said, okay, you guys, here's what we're going to do. We are going to put in the wildest trick play you've ever seen. And I said, we worked on it. We spent the whole practice period on that trick play, a triple reverse, you know, with a throwback pass and a wild. I mean, it was a real tricky. We practiced that thing and practiced it. And I said, now, when Coach Cathcart comes back, I don't care what he said. The first play, you get in the huddle. I don't care if he says sweep, power, whatever it is, option. I don't care. You run the special. And he came up out of there. And he called a play, and our kids executed that thing perfect. Sam, you don't see this very often, his jaw dropped. What in the heck was that? So we had a little fun with it, too. Of course, right here in Peabody Stadium, one of the memorable games for me personally was, and for Sam, was when we played in Muir High School. We were the smallest school in the playoff. Then there was only eight teams in the playoffs. That was it. You were a CIF champion or nothing, just one champion. We played Muir. They were the biggest school in the CIF playoffs. We beat them right here in Peabody Stadium. I was really proud of that. Some of you probably were here and maybe played in that game. But that was it. We went on to win them all that year. I was a guy from Bell High School in the L.A. City School District. That's where I went to high school. Well, I wound up here. Can you imagine a guy from the L.A. City Schools? Who, no big deal down there. I come out here my first game as an assistant coach at Santa Barbara High School. There were extra bleachers he had to be put in. The stands were full. It was standing room only. You remember the big crowds used to stand down there? And they're all cheering for our school. And then all of a sudden, we kick off. They run the ball back to about their 35, or, I mean to us, excuse me. And we run it back, and then I'm standing there. I was the offensive line coach, so I was into the offense too. Here they come, Sam ran 29 sweep, right at our bench. Boy, I can remember that play so clearly. They came around the corner, pop, pop, pop. I don't know, made 30 yards or something. I said, I like that. I'm in, man. Really. So, from that time on, I was a fan. One of Sam's last wishes, and his family will reiterate this, was to support the new stadium project. And it will be done. Do we have Katie and Jacobs down there? Anyway, in your program, it'll tell you if you're interested in helping out, it'll tell you how. I'm totally in support myself. They're getting closer. And they tried to maintain the feelings about Peabody Stadium. I remember probably the last time I visited with Sam was at a Santa Barbara City College football game. Sam was in a wheelchair. After he scolded his son Steve for not letting him do anything, he said, "Man, Steve, he won't let me do anything." Well, of course, that tells you how much Steve cared, because he wouldn't let Sam do anything. So thanks, Steve. But he said, "You know what? The one thing I wish I could do, I wish I could tell our kids, our players, how much we appreciated their playing and how easy they made our job." He said, "I wish I could tell them that. All the kids of the Great Dons and Golden Tornado players, who, you know, they made our careers pretty easy and a lot of fun. I never wanted to go anyplace." And so he said, "Yeah, I wish I could do it." And I'm saying now, okay, Sam, here they are. Buddy, say thanks. Susan, I thank you for him, because I know exactly what he'd say to you. He'd say, "What are you doing standing around? Let's go get busy, get it a pack, man. Come on." I just want to say one more thing. If you get a chance, look at the program that Scotty put together. And there's a photo in there of Sam Cathcart running as a San Francisco 49er. He's up in the air. I think Danny Collin brought that photo to me. And I opened it up at home and looked at it, and I thought, "Oh my God, I expected Sam to come crashing through my door." That photo is Sam Cathcart. You look at his face. I mean, you talk about determination and will. So anyway, on behalf of all of us, and especially the Cathcart family and the extended family, we thank you, and we sure thank Sam Cathcart.
Great stories, huh? Our final speaker, of course, is our son, Scott Cathcart, class of 72. Scott currently is the athletic director at Palomar College in Escondido. And he'd like to talk about this great man, Sam Cathcart, from a family perspective. Scott?
What a setting, huh? The sun came out. And I think Dad had something to do with that. I'm honored to speak today on behalf of our family and about my dad. And with us, he was always Dad. Never Colonel or Coach or Pop or Sam. And I believe he liked that title more than any other that he earned throughout his entire life. I think it was exclusive to the family. And we always called him Dad, and he knew how to answer to that. And he enjoyed that, and I know that we did too. Before highlighting that life that was so well lived, I would like to thank all of the friends and colleagues who have helped us to arrange this event on behalf of the family, and especially for all of you that have come to share this with us today. That would be Joe Nunez and Danny Pollan, Mike Maropoulos and Tyson Wilson for their kind words and eloquent remarks. Of course, Mark Patton and John Zant for helping us to publicize this. The current Santa Barbara High School staff, including Principal John Becchio, Michelle Gayton, Katie Jacobs, Andrew Butcher, and Lieutenant John Blankenship and the Pierre Clayson's Veterans Foundation. John, I have something kind of special for you. There's a lot of Navy guys around here, and Dad was an Army guy, and I know that all the Army guys that are here would agree with me. They would say to you, hey, we like the Navy. Every time we get in a war, you give us a ride. Also, Sergeant John Major John Church and the UCSB Surfriders ROTC unit, wasn't that a wonderful ceremony that they put on this afternoon? And also the Santa Barbara Sea Cadets Color Guard, they did a wonderful job for us. So we appreciate everybody and all you guys for coming here. You know, if you take a look at the program, there's an insert in there. It's on goldenrod paper, and there's a quote in there that my sister Sherry came up with, and it's really poignant, and it hits Dad right to the T. And it says, "Life should not be a journey to the grave with the intention of arriving safely in a pretty and well-preserved body, but rather skin in broadside in a cloud of smoke, thoroughly used up, totally worn out, and loudly proclaiming, wow, what a ride." And that is so right on, Sherry, and that was such a great quote. I think that, you know, my little part of this program would deal specifically with that. I want you to know that at the end, he was all used up. There wasn't anything left, but he was still sharp in his mind. He knew exactly what we were telling him on the day that he passed. And for me, you know, I didn't think he'd ever pass. Not that guy. I mean, it didn't matter if he was 90 or 91 or 100. I always thought Dad would be around. And he gave me the opportunity as the youngest in the family to be a kid at 40, to be a kid at 50, to be a kid at 60 still. And I always felt that way. I remember driving away the night that he was going to pass, and I was going back down to go to work the next day in San Marcos. And I thought about, hey, you know what? I'm not a kid anymore, because Dad's not there to give me the guidance. And I called him almost every week, you know, my entire life, or maybe twice or three times, to get, advice from him, to learn how to live from him. And he was willing to offer it. He taught us how to live. I'd like to just kind of start out with Sam's life. Sam was clearly a member of the Greatest Generation that was popularized by Tom Brokaw. He was born to Alfred and Myrtle Cathcart on a farm in Canute, Oklahoma, July 7th, 1924. You know, they thought he was going to come on the 4th of July, and that's why they named him Sam. My grandpa, Alfred Franklin Cathcart, he was a World War I veteran. And his all-time hero was Woodrow Wilson. And that's where my dad got that middle name. It came from Woodrow Wilson. And he was a longtime staunch Democrat. My grandpa, he was the first guy who said, hey, Nixon, Nixon. Yeah, you're not going to vote for that guy. Both Alfred and Myrtle were first generation born in America. Alfred's family came from Scotland, and they settled in Illinois, and Myrtle's family came from Denmark, and they settled in South Dakota, and they met and wound up getting married and they moved to Oklahoma. I don't know whose idea that was, but they decided they were going to be farmers in Oklahoma. And, you know, Dad didn't live in Oklahoma very long. He was only there. He was the fourth or fifth of five children. He had an older brother by the name of Al, and then he had an older sister by the name of Roseman and Irene, and then there was Sam, and then his younger brother, Royal. And in 1927, when he was only three or maybe just about four, they decided they were going to move to California. They packed up the truck, and the entire family, one truck, if you can imagine that, 1927, they drove to California. It's a kind of a funny story. I was watching The Grapes of Wrath with my dad one time. And I said, boy, Dad, that's got to really hit home. That's almost like when Grandpa brought you guys to California. And he said, hell no, that isn't like the way it was when we came to California. Grandpa had a plan. He sold the farm. He had a job waiting for him when we got to California. He had it figured out. And then he said, you know, when the Okies came to California, and they came here for the oil jobs. You know, all the dumb Okies went to Bakersfield and all the smart Okies went to Long Beach. And thank God my dad was a smart Okie. So we wound up in Long Beach. They started out in Pasadena, they moved to Huntington Park, and then in the ensuing years they moved to Long Beach. And his childhood, you know, they hitchhiked to the beach so they could body surf down in Long Beach. They were always active. He and Royal together learned how to play tennis and learned how to play baseball and had foot races and they had boxing matches. My grandpa would tell everybody, hey, Sam's the toughest kid in town. He can lick any kid in town. And that was true. You know, he'd just tell me, say, hey, you know, see that kid over there, Sam? I want you to go and lick that kid. Don't come back until you do. And I think that's where some of his toughness came from. But that's the way the world was in the early 30s. You know, he had to learn to deal with death at an early age. He lost his brother Al in 1936 when Al was only 18 and my dad, I think, was either 11 or 12. And that was a very tough, hard time. Al had contracted cancer and had passed away at a very young age. It was tough on my grandpa and on the entire family. And as it turned out, his entire family passed before he did. He was the last man standing of the entire generation from both sides of the family. Went on to Pauley High School and met my mother there. He was a class ahead of my mother. My dad was an outstanding athlete at Pauley High School. We were going to let him play football. Orion Landreth, who was the football coach and the track coach, said, hey, he's too valuable to us as a sprinter and a hurdler. We're not going to let him get beat up playing football. He only weighs 170 pounds. And so, or probably in those days, probably about 160. And but he wanted to play football. He was determined to play football. They wouldn't have him playing football as a junior. So he only played 1 year of high school football. And actually, his first visit to Peabody Stadium was as a Long Beach Pauley Jackrabbit playing against Clarence Shooty's Dons. And I think he had a pretty good game here. And he got an idea that he really liked Santa Barbara. That was back in the back of his mind way back then. After high school, he was working at McDonnell Douglas, and the country was gearing up for war, but it wasn't yet in the war. During that summer, somebody came to him and said, hey, you know, if you go to Long Beach City College, we can enroll in school. We can play more football. He says, hey, I'm all about that. Let's go. And so they went and they played football at Long Beach City College. He was telling me about when he played for them. They traveled up to the Rose Bowl to play Pasadena City College at the Rose Bowl. Okay, they went in a steak bed truck. And they threw their equipment up there in duffel bags, and they all jumped up on that open steak bed truck to ride from Long Beach up to Pasadena. And that was before the Long Beach Freeway was there. They went all the way up on Atlantic Avenue. And made it all the way up to the Rose Bowl and played the Rose Bowl. At the end of that season, Pearl Harbor happened, and he was drafted in January of 1943. And he went to the classification center in San Bernardino. His parents took him up, put him on a train at Union Station in Los Angeles. He went out to San Bernardino. In his memoirs, he wrote at the classification center, they figured out he was best suited for digging holes and shooting a rifle. So he was on his way to an infantry unit. He was assigned to the yet-to-be-commissioned 75th Infantry Division training at Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. And while he was there, they went on maneuvers down in Louisiana. And my dad had said that that's when it really all clicked for him in his military career. He had already broken, out of all those GIs that were coming through there, he set all of the records at Fort Leonard Wood for physical fitness tests. Every record there was, pull-ups, sit-ups, push-ups, sprinting, long distance running, all of that stuff. And there was, I think Sam Demas, who lived in Long Beach and was a friend of my dad's, had told me the most impressive thing he did, not including UCSB or the 49ers or any of that, the most impressive thing he did athletically was set all the records for physical fitness at Fort Leonard Wood. When they went down to Louisiana to go on maneuvers, you know, the guy just had leadership written all over him. He was better than everybody else. And I know I'm saying that as his son, but, you know, hey, it's true. It ain't brag, it's just fact. on a furlough, he came back to Pasadena before the as a unit was being put together. It was a newly commissioned unit that started after the war had started. It was one of the last units that was ever developed, the 75th Division. If you know anything about military science, a division is between 15 and 20,000 men. So it includes regiments and battalions and regimental combat teams and platoons and companies and that stuff. And he knew a lot about that. And when you asked him about the war and what he did in the war, he would always talk about the organization. He'd talk about it from a big picture. You know, you should have seen how much material we moved. You should have seen how they moved us. You should have seen how we moved in unison and what kind of discipline we had. You would have been impressed with that, Scott. And I would say something like, well, you know, tell me about combat, Dad. I don't really want to talk about that. But, you know, you'd kind of get him to come around, and as the later years got on, we did get him to talk about that a little bit. And he says, well, you know, combat, it's a lot like a football game. That's all we understand. You know, you run like hell to get through the line of scrimmage, and then you try to exploit once you get beyond that. And I was pretty good at getting through that line of scrimmage, and I was able to, keep myself from getting killed and also effective. And I think he really believed that because there were a lot of people around him that were killed. If you read the story of the 75th Division, and you can go online and look at what they did, they were supposed to be an occupying force in Europe. They were not supposed to be in the war. The war was supposed to be over by Christmas of 1944. And there was this engagement in the Ardennes known as the Battle of the Bulge, and they wound up being thrown into the breach of that. And they were used as a combat unit, and they were pretty green, but they came in as a fighting unit. He was a member of the 291st Regimental Combat Team, and he was a platoon sergeant and a platoon guide. In addition to half his squad were lost to rifle, mortar, and artillery fire, frostbite, and sickness. Subsequently, Sam became the second date rank non-commissioned officer in his platoon. After they had helped to wrap up the with several other many units, many thousands and thousands of men wrapped up the Battle of the Bulge and started to push east. He was involved in fighting in Wolfganzen, France. And I looked it up on the map. You can go online and take a look and find out where Wolfganzen is, and it's right on the Rhine River. It's in the extreme northeastern corner of France, and it's the it's on the doorstep of Germany. And in the Colmar Pocket fighting, it has to be said, because you need to know this about him, he at the age of 20 took control of his unit, found a machine gun nest that was causing the bulk of the damage to their unit and holding up their charge, took it upon himself ahead of an armored unit that was not willing to go over the ground that he went over on foot, took on a machine gun nest, routed the Germans that were in the machine gun nest, ran out of ammunition, was wounded, and wound up killing the remaining two Germans with the butt of his rifle. And you know, in these days, you know, we hear a lot about the post-traumatic syndrome and how that might have affected him the rest of his life. He put that behind him and forgot about it. You know, what he said about the war to me was, you know, all we want to do is get it over with and get home to mom. That's what I wanted to do. And never had any doubt in their mind that they were going to win and prevail. And once they got into Germany and the fighting subsided, as a matter of fact, if you look on that yellow sheet, you'll see that May 8th, 1944 was my dad's wedding day, and May 8th, 1945 was VE Day. And there's pictures from both of those. That's his guys in the 291st Regimental Combat Team, and he's holding the Stars and Stripes there. That's VE Day 1945. So those two pictures are a year apart. What a world of difference. And you know, for all of us that knew him, you knew he was like the epitome of tough. Mike mentioned it, and I don't think I ever knew anybody that had that much toughness and. Didn't have to tell anybody about it. You know, just it just was there. He had the opportunity to run on the division track team, play on the division football team. The reason he got to come home is because he broke his ankle playing football and he had a broken wrist, so he couldn't walk on crutches. And that all happened in those extracurricular activities, and that got him an opportunity to come home. And he got to New York, he got on a train, he rode the train back to Union Station, hitchhiked down to Long Beach, and the war was over. At that point, he got an opportunity to take advantage of the GI Bill and went to UCSB, and he was an outstanding athlete at UCSB, as Mike had mentioned, and is in the story. But one thing I'll say about his UCSB years, I saw some newspaper articles that my mom had saved, a little bit of a scrapbook, but there was never anything around our house that was really formal like that. But if you read those stories of those games, he had like a 96-yard kickoff return, a 65-yard punt return, intercept the pass and run it back 85 yards, like in the same game. You know, his all-purpose yards were just like beyond, adding them all up. And when he got done at UCSB, his coach, Stan Williamson, was a friend of Buck Shaw, and Buck Shaw was the coach of the 49ers. And Buck had called Stan and said, hey, and that's the way the pro teams back in the 40s, you know, there wasn't all this international or national communication and all that kind of stuff. In the 40s, they asked their guys that were playing on their team. They only had 33 guys on the 49ers, so almost everybody was a two-way player, 33 guys. And they were all almost local, they're all local guys. Frank Albert was from Stanford, and you know, R.C. Owens was from Santa Monica, and Joe Perry was from Compton, and Hugh McElhaney was from Compton. And what they did was they asked their guys, hey, who do you think could play on our team back from your college, or who do you know? And that's how the word got around. Well, Stan Williamson was a friend of Buck Shaw's, and Buck Shaw said, hey, we heard you guys have one hell of a punt returner there at Santa Barbara. That's what we need. We need a punt returner, a kick returner. And so he says, yeah, we got one. And so he got an invitation to go up and have a tryout with the 49ers. An undrafted free agent. They had a draft. He decided to go a week late to report to training camp. Showed up there a week late. He had more important things to do with his education and trying to get his master's degree at UCSB, and he called him and said, I'll be up there, but I'm going to be up a week late. You can imagine somebody nowadays passing on an opportunity to go try out with an NFL team and not being there on time. Well, it really worked out great, and Dad told the story, you know, when he got there, you know, the NFL wasn't a thing where they had all these OTAs or anything. They played into shape as the season started. It was a seasonal thing. They didn't keep, you know, all those guys went and sold cars after the season was over with. They weren't getting paid that much. So he got up there to camp, and he had fresh legs. He's in the best shape of his life. He told me he'd been running on the beach with combat boots. And he got up there, and everybody was sore. Everybody was all beat up. You know how those first few days, all the Don's football players that are here remember the first days of Hell Week and how sore you were trying to get up for that first morning practice? Well, all those guys were like that. He came in there and dressed out for that first practice, and they had a scrimmage, and Stan called him over and said, Sam, get in there, you're going to run a 27 jab. I want to see how you can do. And they gave him the ball, he made a fake and opened it up so the end slid out, and they got a nice block. And he said, hey, that thing opened up like a big garage door. And he ran through that thing in that scrimmage and went like 65 yards for a touchdown. And the first play, he touched the ball with the 49ers. By the end of the second practice, you know, Buckshot came over and he says, well, Sam, I guess you realize you've made the ball club. And he told Buck, he said, and, you know, they didn't have any general manager. They had four coaches. The coach did all the contracts. It was really kind of a loosely run thing. You know, by the way, if you look at the picture that we have at Dad that Mike was talking about, you see the 49ers logo there in the right, lower right corner of that? That was their logo when he was playing for the team. And they figured out that that was politically incorrect in about 1962. Because that 49ers got a gun in one hand and a bottle of booze in the other, and he's like a crazy man. But they got rid of that logo. They don't use that anymore. But it kind of exemplifies what the NFL and what pro football was like in the late 40s and early 50s. It was as wild as the Wild West. And even his dad thought, you know, Sam, you know, when are you going to get a real job? You know, how long are you going to play this football? So, in 1951 came along, and we were in the Korean War, so he got reactivated because he had, at UCSB, he had studied military science, and he had taken a commission as a second lieutenant, and so they reactivated him for the Korean War. And he said, he told me, hey, I didn't want to go to Korea. I didn't want to have anything to do with any more combat or be in war anymore. And he got an opportunity because he was a professional physical educator and you know, had his had all of his degrees and everything in that area, that they wound up assigning him as the recreation officer at Camp Roberts. And the guy at Camp Roberts, who's the commanding officer, says, Cathcart, I want you to take a truck and get some guys and go up to the Presidio and get us some boxing equipment. So they took a deuce and a half and three guys, and they went up to the Presidio. And when he got there, he reported to the commanding officer at the Presidio, and he said, hey, I'm here. We called ahead. We want to get some boxing equipment to take down at Camp Roberts. And he said, you fill your truck with boxing equipment, Cathcart, but you're staying right here. You're not going back. And so they made him the recreation officer because the guy had known him from playing for the 49ers. And he was right there in San Francisco. And he said, we're going to keep you here. We're going to have you be our recreation officer. So he worked at Letterman Army Hospital in that 1951 season, had to miss the entire season. And came back in 1952 with no prospects, but they knew who he was, and just made the team again. Had to make the team, had to make another, you know, 33-man roster and made the team. By the end of that 52 season, he was getting ready for the 53 season. He had an opportunity to come back to UCSB and coach and do his student teaching at Santa Barbara High School, and he jumped at that chance. He knew that that he had loved Santa Barbara while he was here in college, and he thought that would be a good destination for him. And thank God for all of us that he made that decision. And so he came to Santa Barbara High, and Mike really covered, you know, my dad's career at Santa Barbara High. He found fantastic assistant coaches, tremendous student athletes, and had a great run here. I think, you know, nobody could have been prouder and our family in every year when the football season came around, and how exciting it was and how much that meant to all of us to come to the games. Our seats, you know, back in those days, they had reserved seats. They had ushers. They filled the place. Our seats were right there. We sat right next to Johnny Chuchevis. You know, he always said, turn them loose at the end of the national anthem. And Mike knows that. And we had a great time all those years. We had to get dressed, come to game, and you know, looked the part. The game started at 8 o'clock. I'm an athletic administrator. You'd never start a game at 8 o'clock. You know, you wouldn't get, never get away with that. But it was a big deal in town, and we really appreciate it. A couple of things that I remember as my dad's coach that were kind of funny. They had a quarterback by the name of Dave Lipke, and Dave was on, I think, the 68 or 69 team. Well, those are the two of the very best teams that they ever had. And got late in the game, and you know, the Dons were ahead like 54-6 over somebody like Camarillo or somebody like that, and Dave was going into the game, and Dave says to my dad, he says, "Hey, Mr. Cathcart, since it's the end of the game and we just about got this thing wrapped up, how about I call all the plays for this series? Because you know my dad called every play." And my dad says, "Well, how about I call all the plays and we go down here and score?" And so Dave went out and he got the calls from dad and they went down and scored. There was another time when we were in a practice. And I was here for this, but Mark Pizzotti was an offensive lineman for us, and he was a real intelligent student, good student at the high school. And he had told my dad right in the huddle, you know, he says, "So, Mr. Cathcart, I just don't understand the philosophy of that play." And my dad looked around and he goes, "The philosophy of the play? You get the damn guy blocked, and I'll show you the philosophy of the play. The philosophy of the play is that we're going to make a first down." As I close up, my dad actually, he was good at writing lists, and one of the things I missed was, the family life I want to talk about. Tom Hort is here. Yeah, Tommy. And Tom's parents and our family were really close, and Tom's dad, who was the principal at Franklin Elementary School, they lived on our block over on the Mesa, and they had a boat and they had a cabin at Nacimiento Lake, and they got us the opportunity to be into that. And you know, having us be together all the time and making those trips really meant a lot to my dad. He wanted the entire family together at all times. As a matter of fact, Sam and I played on a city championship midget league team. Rod Dauhauer was the coach, and we wanted to come back and play the championship games at Laguna Park. You know, to play at Laguna Park in those days, that was a big deal. And dad just wouldn't budge. You know, "Hey, you guys are going to the lake. We're staying up there. That's the call." He actually called for, and Fred called for us, and called him. He said, "Fred, this is more important in the long run for these guys to be here with the family and spend the family vacation together." And you could imagine that from a coach, that an activity that was a sporting activity. But he had a list of what he was most thankful for. And I think he came up with this rather late. And he wanted to make sure that somebody said this or somebody read this. So this falls to me. This is a good opportunity for me to share this with all of you. Susan, above all, his wife Susan, what he was most thankful for. They made a great team, and we had a wonderful family life. The kids, the grandkids, the great-grandkids, our wonderful homes. And, you know, when we talk about homes, we have to mention the Sycamore Canyon fire of 77. I was just graduating from college at Fresno when that fire happened. I didn't think it was a big deal. And I found out that our house had burned to the ground, as 280 homes up in the Sycamore Canyon area had burned. And, came back to Santa Barbara, and there's like nothing left there. And I think my dad was probably about 51 or 52. And Lincho Villa had us over at the tee off for dinner that night. We all sat down and we said, "Well, what are we gonna do?" And we all said, you know, Sam and Steve and I and Sherry, you know, "Hey, Dad, we'll do whatever you want us to do. We'll build it back." And he said, yeah, "We'll do that. We'll build it back." And nobody doubted him that was something we could do. And that house is a split-level home that overlooks the Sycamore Canyon. It's up on Los Alturas Road, and that's been a very special thing for us. It burned again a second time in the tea fire, and he had somebody else rebuild it that time. We were all too busy. But having that opportunity to work with him and build a house, I mean, he was... I miss that part too. You know, he came from that oaky background where you didn't throw anything away and you could make something out of anything. I mean, he wouldn't let you throw away a nail from an old board. You had to straighten it back out and put it back in the can so you could use it. And he was not always easy to be with. You know, I mean, we have projects around the house he'd have us work on, and you know, he'd say, "Okay, Scotty, I want you to run around the house and go into the garage and find me a 5/8 inch box end wrench." And you go, "Oh God, you know, okay, all right, I'll be right back, Dad." And you'd be on your way there and you go, "God, I hope that wrench is there. I hope that wrench is there. I hope that wrench." And you'd like, you wouldn't even have gotten to the edge of the house yet. You'd be gone about 30 seconds. You go, "Where the hell are are you? Get that thing back here. You know, well, wait a minute. You know, you go in there and you look, where is it? Where is it? Where is it? You know, you'd hope you'd find it. Sometimes you'd find it and sometimes you wouldn't. But, or a nut or a bolt, you know, find me a 3/8, Steve and I were talking about this, find me a 3/8 inch, you know, box in, bolt with a nut and a washer on it, and bring that back here too. He'd be up on the ladder, you know, waiting for that, you know. So he wasn't easy to get along with. And the entire time when we built the house back in 77, I could say this, I think we pulled more nails out than we hammered in. You know, we made a mistake, we went back, you know, is it level, is it plumb, is it square? And you know what, we wound up building a pretty good house. It wound up being a pretty, anybody that's ever been up there to visit us, that house means a lot to us. Our health, you know, I always had good health. Everybody in the family had good health. You know, my brother struggled with diabetes from the time he was 4, and I don't mean to embarrass you, Sam, but Sam handled that really well, and my mom and dad, my mother was like his nurse, and when you contracted type 1 diabetes in the 50s, that was a very serious thing, and Sam lived his entire life with that, and that's a tribute to Sam. We're proud of you, Sam. You did a great job. Retirement and golf. You love to play golf. Steve and I played golf with Dad and Sam. We played golf with him. He moved up in his later years to Santa Maria. We played at Rancho Marina. We played 2 or 3 times a week, and he always picked me up. We went to the same place to pick up coffee on the way. Never had to have a starting time. Never had to have anybody in front of us. Never waited to hit a shot. Just got out there and walked and played. He carried his own clubs into his 80s and really enjoyed the game. Literally hundreds of friends and relatives. Our Southern California weather. His teammates at Poly High, Long Beach City College, UC Santa Barbara, and the 49ers. His 75th Division Brothers in Arms and the U.S. Army as a whole. His assistant coaches and educational colleagues at Santa Barbara High School and every one of his Santa Barbara Don players. And with that, you know, he'd be saying, Scott, would you get off that thing so we could get to the party? So I'm going to turn this back over to Joby, but thank you all once again from our family and our heart for you coming here to be with us today. Thank you.
Are you done? Anyway, before we close with the singing of the Santa Barbara High School alma mater, led by Danny Pauling, class of 67, I want to share one more last story, if I can. Back in January 2014, Danny Pauling hosted a barbecue for ex-players, and the whole intent of it was to have players from the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, to honor Coach Cathcart and Coach Moropoulos. And we had about 75 or 80 guys show up, and some of you guys are sitting up there in the stands right now. Frank Galindo, Manuel Blado, and Louis Herrera, they did the barbecuing. And Sam was sick. He was in the hospital that day. And God, I don't know. Do you think he's going to make it, you guys? I don't think so. True to his character, the toughness that Sam Cathcart had, he showed up. We had a wonderful afternoon, told stories. The stories get better every year. Told stories, took photographs, and it was really probably the last time many of you got to see Sam Cathcart. Anyway, at the end of this memorial, the Cathcart family wants to sincerely thank all of you for being here today. There's going to be a no-host get-together at the Fest Parkers Red Lion Inn, probably going to start around 3, 3:30. You're all welcome to stay and look at the great photographs of the family and visit with one another. And at this time, that concludes our program. Would you please all stand, and Danny Pauling is going to lead us in singing the alma mater. Danny Pauling.
Remind you guys that in the program, the words are written there. You see, I never knew the words because when we played football, we were ushered off the field, and the rest of the student body would stay back and sing the song.
So I earned it. I learned it this week, I think. But don't depend on me. I'm depending on you guys. So you got to carry me up there. So we're going to have to sing this without any music. We're just going to sing Santa Barbara Hail to Thee. And I'm going to throw one thing in about Joby was saying about Coach Cathcart. I had the opportunity to visit him after the party. And I went up there. So gracious. I visited him for 3 hours, and he never lost a heartbeat. Man, I was taking everything I had to stay up with this guy. He knew everything, and he remembered everything. And I felt really honored to be able to share that time. So, here we go. We're going to sing the Alma Mater, Santa Barbara, Hail to Thee. And we'll go one, and we'll hold up our victory. Okay, here you go. Santa Barbara, hail to thee, strong thy kind shall ever be. Son and daughter, praise thy name, honor thee and spread thy fame. Learning and fellowship, all most deep graven these on every heart. Strong thy tie shall ever be, Santa Barbara, hail to thee.
Santa Barbara, hail to thee.